and requests. Can all the mothers come forward here? All of you have to come as forward. Come forward. Omagyanakimidantasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakran Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Bhave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Krishnam Sthapitanam Yena Uttare Svayam Rupa Karama Yuyam Rati Svapanandikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yudhakamalam Shri Guru Vaishnavamsha Shri Rupam Sahajatam Sankana Ragnatam Vidam Sajivam Sakvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sajanam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Pada Sahagana Lalita Shri Shadhanvitam Cha He Krishna Varuna Sindho Hira Bandho Jagat Pate Gopesha Bhupika Kanchana Gaurangi Rahe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanamukute Devi Pranamami Haripriye Vanchatalpagarubhyascha Kupanasindurubhyayevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Om Vishnu Padaya, Krishna Krishna, Bhutale, Srimate Bhakti Vedanta, Swami, Vidne, Namaste Saraswati Deve, Gauravani, Nirvisheshasunyavani, Vajrasunyavani, Okay. So, recap of last week. What all did we discuss last week? Anybody can see that? Few points quickly and then we'll move on. What do you recollect?
First was the Mangala
Dharma. Mercy of the Supreme Lord. Correct. Thank you. Okay. Thank you. Any other? Okay. Thank you. Any other thing you recollect?
How desire is the root of suffering?
How?
Desire is the root of suffering.
Yes, desire is the root of suffering.
Desire leads to action. We contemplate on it and we act on it.
Yes.
So, monom is not keeping in silence, but it is talking, involving in discussing about Krishna.
Correct. So, one of the key points that we discussed was Rupa Goswami is speaking about Vacho Vegam. Srila Prabhupada said that Vacho Vegam means control of the tongue, which means speaking Krishna Katha.
We discussed how it is talking about Krishna is still.
Okay. We'll come close one by one, step by step. So we also discussed that the Nectar of Instruction is a series of verses which takes us all the way from Shraddha to Prema. And one, we had a skit too. So every week when we start this verse, let us recite these verses. How many of you remember this verse by heart by now? Raise your hands. Okay. So now, let us all together repeat this verse 5 times. At least, if nobody has time to remember, memorize it at home, we'll try to do it here itself. Okay, let's start.
Vacho Vegam Manasa Krodha Vegam Jitva Vegam Udaropasta Vegam etam vegam yogiseshvaniya sarvam abhimam vidvasishya vacho vegam manasatrodha vegam jihva vegam udaropastha vegam etam vegam yogiseshvaniya sarvam abhimam vidvasishya vacho vegam manasatrodha vegam jihva vegam udaropastha vegam etam vegam yogiseshvaniya sarvam abhimam vacho vegam manasa krodha vegam jihva vegam udaropastha vegam etam vegam yogiśa pratyatīrah sarvam abhimam vidvasishya vacho vegam manasa krodha vegam jihva vegam udaropastha vegam etam vegam yogiśa pratyatīrah sarvam abhimam vidvasishya.
So if you see this image at the bottom, it looks like that the keys in a keyboard. Anger, speech, stomach, genitals, all of this need one trigger and then starts a chain reaction. So that is what Rupa Goswami is saying, that even when there is a trigger, one must Swami is trying to tell us that the one person who is able to resist what happens when these urges come, he is capable of having disciples, or he is a suitable preacher. And this entire movement is all about how we progress towards glorifying Krishna in various ways by our activities. So, exemplifying the qualities which Rupa Goswami is saying in our own lives, and looking forward for these very same qualities in our teachers. This is part of the reason why we are studying this year. So, we get an idea that if I have to accept guidance from somebody, who should that be? They should have these qualities. And most of the times what happens is, we have these glorified ideas that yes, they should be Vacho Vegam, Manasa Krodha Vegam, and I am not seeing any of these qualities in them at all. It's probably due to our own conditioning. We tend to see all the faults in others, but we need a right perspective on seeing how these qualities are manifest in devotees around us. Many times, in reality, even a newcomer to Krishna consciousness will be exhibiting these qualities. But we fail to recognize it. And to the extent we recognize it, to that extent, it means that Krishna's mercy has come in our lives. It's not due to our own qualifications. Somehow the process of chanting of the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra is working wonders. We many times we think, why are my hairs not standing on end? Why am I not sweating profusely? Why are tears not gliding out from my eyes? These are the highest stage. Actually, in the beginning stages, recognizing the qualities and the sacrifices of devotees is a manifestation of the mercy of Krishna in our lives. So, we read the purport of Srila Prabhupada and then we split it into the key points, which is number one, control of speech is essential. There are things to be avoided, which is unnecessary talking and topics which are not related to Krishna, and even silence in the name of austerity of speech. What is to be encouraged is speaking about Krishna Katha. And Srila Prabhupada gives a benediction that the preacher of Krishna Katha is always beyond the clutches of death. Time willing, we will come to an exercise based on that.
We spoke about our concept of 2.3.2.
Yes, we'll come. So that's three. So these are the questions for this purport that we are trying to address. Why is Rupa Goswami beginning the Padishamta with this verse? We discussed this completely last week. Then why should we control the urges? We discussed that too. Now, the next is what Nagarajan was speaking about. Why controlling speech means speaking only Krishna? What is the scriptural reference for that? That was from Srimad Bhagavatam, Shaunaka's statements to Suta Goswami. So, I'll again revisit that verse. Now, today, what we are going to speak is, or what we are going to discuss is, Srila Prabhupada spoke about Vacho Vegam, means speak only Krishna Katha. But I still want to explore it further. But with the moment, controlling speech means it has so many aspects of it, right? Why Srila Prabhupada didn't speak about it? Why is he speaking this way? So, we'll try to see, is Prabhupada coming with his own interpretation while giving this verse, or what else is he doing? So that's one aspect we want to do. Second, we want to expand Vacho Vegam a little bit more and see, throughout the rest of the scriptures, what do they speak about Vacho Vegam? Of course, it will not be comprehensive. We'll just cover one or two verses from here and there. So, what are the other aspects of Vacho Vegam from the scriptural perspective? And why are we doing this? Because this is a study class. We have to be very clear about whatever Shastras. We have to understand the statements of Shastras from different perspectives. That is one component. And another component is how we apply in our lives. Many times, what happens is within the way we are conditioned, probably due to our conditioning, we like to hear stories and stories and stories and stories. And through that, in between, we will give, if there is one message, wow, that's great. But if you see the structure of Bhagavad Gita, or the structure of Srimad Bhagavatam, it is not about all about stories. So, even in my presentation here, I don't want to go fully with story, completely. There will be a little bit of time for philosophy. And the reason I'm doing it is, we need to exercise our attention span to hear philosophy. Many times we don't exercise our brain to be attentive to philosophy. We switch off. And the moment we switch it off, then we are conditioned to just hearing these stories. So, part of this exercise, bear with me, is we listen to some philosophy and then we come to katha. It's not all katha. So, after we speak a little bit of those philosophy, then we also come to another philosophical point, which is, what happens if we don't speak about Krishna? What are the consequences in our own lives? And then comes the katha part. Some examples where Vacho Vegam was exhibited, some examples where Vacho Vegam was not exhibited. Most likely, I think this is all that we can cover today. And further applications, especially in family life and with children in particular, because I'm having some of the devotees here who are taking care of Bhakta Prahlad school, so it would resonate with them even more, if not with the parents. So, we talked about the necessity to control urges last week, and controlling speech means speaking Krishna Katha. This was the verse, one of the verses we discussed yesterday, last week, which is Shaunaka to Sutta, where he says that one who has not listened to the messages about the prowess and marvelous acts of the personality of Godhead and has not sung or chanted loudly the worthy songs about the Lord is to be considered both as ear holes, like the holes of snakes, and a tongue, like the tongue of a frog. And one key point in the purport, which we discussed last week, is Srila Prabhupada writes there, many want to speak something to others, but because they are not trained to speak on the subject matter of Vedic wisdom, they are all speaking nonsense, and people are receiving them with no sense. There are hundreds and thousands of sources for distributing mundane news of the world, and people of the world are also receiving it. Similarly, the people of the world should be taught to hear the transcendental topics of the Lord, and the devotee of the Lord must speak loudly so that they can hear. So, Srila Prabhupada again exemplifying the same point given here in the first verse of the proper instruction. Now, coming to this session today. So, the question that I raised earlier, is Srila Prabhupada coming up with his own concocted thing about Vacho Vegam means speak only Krishna Katha? Yeah, there is some reference here in the Bhagavatam about it. But why is he not speaking about anything else? Prior to Srila Prabhupada, Bhaktivinoda Thakur wrote a book called Bhaktyaloka. In the Bhaktyaloka, he gave a commentary on the Nectar of Instruction and several other books of Srila Rupa Goswami. One of the paragraphs there is about the Nectar of Instruction first verse. And this is what Bhaktivinoda Thakur has written here. There are six types of urges, namely the urges of speech, mind, anger, belly, tongue and genitals. With the desire to speak more, a person becomes talkative. If speech is not regulated, then enmity arises from talking about others. To speak uselessly is the business of a fool. But out of the desire to unnecessarily engage in speech, the materialist always waste time and face so many diseases. And I'll cut it short, I'll come here. The practitioners of devotional service should not speak unnecessarily. If you do have to speak unnecessarily, better to keep quiet. Besides topics regarding Krishna, all other topics are unnecessary. But to speak about the subject favorable to devotional service is not unnecessary. Therefore, devotees should speak only on topics about Lord Hari or those favorable to such topics. Here we see Srila Prabhupada exemplifying the following in the disciplic succession.
I wanted to know what is the meaning of what is unnecessary talk? Clearly defined. Besides topics regarding Krishna, all other topics are unnecessary.
Yes. Thank you.
That was the first point about avoiding. Avoid unnecessary talk.
Yes.
What was unnecessary? I wanted to know what was unnecessary and immediately.
Yes. And we are going to come again further on that point. A little later by later. So what else do the acharyas speak on Vacho Vegam? So this is collected from Srila Prabhupada's conversations and other books as such. So Srila Prabhupada also says, a child can be excused, but if a person who is in spiritual life, he cannot control, then he is hopeless. So Srila Prabhupada is saying that for those who are practitioners, they should make an attempt to regulate their sense of speech. It is not easy, it is tough, definitely. But Srila Prabhupada says the mark of a person who is practicing spiritual life is that he is trying for it. The result depends on Krishna's mercy. Result is not with us. But our efforts should be in that direction. Next, Srila Prabhupada also says, common man cannot control the urges. He needs to learn discipline under Guru. If we control, then we can preach. So, an important point that is coming here is we lay the same standards of what Rupa Goswami is talking about to everybody. But Srila Prabhupada is very considerate here. In the beginning stage, it is very tough for us to follow. He's saying this very clearly. But those who are preachers, they should control. And most of you in this group here, sooner or later, or you are already preaching to others. Therefore, we should keep in mind, we should be conscious, I am a representative of Rupa Goswami. Being a representative of Rupa Goswami means, I follow his instructions. And so we become aware. Sometimes we are aware, but we are unable to control what to do. In those cases, what is essential is that number one, we acknowledge our failure or our frailties to some other devotee, so especially those who are guiding us. Be honest about it. And number two, have a deep sense of regret. When there is regret, then we can progress forward. Because regret is the fire which burns the result of all the past sinful activities. And we commit sinful activities, or we are unable, we talk these unnecessary things which leads to so many other things in our life because of past impressions. And to burn all of that requires regret. So genuine regret is essential. But not regret which goes to the extent of self-deprecation and takes away individual endeavor. I am so bad, I am not fit to do anything. I don't think I should do any of this because I am a fallen soul. No, that is not what Srila Prabhupada said. So if you recognize your mistake, try to avoid it in the future. Go forward. So the qualification to preach is to be alert about one's urges, and you should strive to act as per Shastra. And the other is, we, as Srila Prabhupada said, he has to learn discipline under a guru, which means we have to be pliable, to be molded by somebody. Many times we say, Guru Maharaj, if he says, I will do. But how often do we even write to Guru Maharaj? Or how often do we say the truth to Guru Maharaj? How often do we talk to him? No, we put out our best face forward. You know, BFF, whatever you call it. It's a different way of saying BFF. So our best face comes out. Guru Maharaj, you are so great. There is nobody like you. There is nobody as fallen as I am. I am trying to preach and there are so many things I am doing here, as if expecting a praise from them. But nothing else comes out. So, to learn to be disciplined means, typically it happens through the association even of our peers. Especially when we work together, somebody may point out something and we have to be conscious of it. Why peers? Sometimes it happens even through the agency of people whom we have not. And that's wonderful. It's great. It doesn't mean that I am at a higher position, they are at a lower position. Devotional service is dynamic. Krishna can teach us lessons through anybody in this world. Just like how we heard about Rupa Goswami. He learned something from a washerman on the road, not his wife. They were not learned in Shastras. They were not chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. But he felt Krishna's message is coming through them. So, be alert to be disciplined. Next, what else is coming on Vacho Vegam? Again, Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, Vacho Vegam is giving up prajalpa. And he says, by giving up prajalpa, talking about unnecessary topics, the urge to speak is permanently regulated. In order to pass one's life without sin, one should not speak anything more than whatever little is necessary. One needs to discuss only whatever is auspicious for oneself and others. If one wants to discuss topics of others, it will simply be useless speech. So, one of the points I have highlighted here is, discuss only whatever is auspicious for oneself and others. And this requires considerable thought. It requires us to think, what is it that if I speak will be useful for me? And for different people, there are different stages in life where we can be of some value to them. And for some people, it is not just speech that matters, it is our action. Like say for example, you have a senior devotee. And this senior devotee is in a stage where he is sacrificing and sacrificing and sacrificing his life. What happens? If there is no reciprocation from others, there is a possibility that he may feel, what is it that's happening with me? I am telling everybody but nobody is reciprocating. Maybe I am not going on the right path. So, one of the ways in which we can reciprocate with him is to say, Prabhu, thank you for this wonderful class, thank you for your sacrifices, you have done so much to give us this infrastructure for what you are doing to us, you are taking care of so many devotees. Expressing our gratitude by words is also part of our Vacho Vegam. When we speak about Krishna Katha, giving encouragement to other devotees is part of this Vacho Vegam. because it is auspicious. It means that you become a via media for Krishna's mercy to enter this life. He already has a lot of mercy in his life. That's why he is acting in that platform. But you can give further impetus to them. That's how we deal with seniors. And likewise, we can encourage others. Okay?
Line which you highlighted. Discuss only whatever is auspicious for oneself and others. In the following line itself, one wants to discuss topics of others, it will be simply interesting.
Yes. The topics of others is to discuss, when Bhaktivinoda Thakur is talking here, he is specifically speaking about, he has this good quality, has that bad quality, delving too much on the bad quality of others especially. Or this is the typical prajalpa way. For devotees, glorifying other devotees is not prajalpa.
That means that yellow part.
The yellow part, yes. That is auspicious. The inauspicious thing is to pigeonhole somebody into a particular characteristic. Or putting him into, limiting somebody to just saying, because he did this, he is like this. Especially devotees, you cannot pigeonhole them. They are very dynamic. Because they are chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra every day, Krishna's mercy is coming in their life. What they are yesterday, they may not be the same today. Even on a daily basis, they change because of Krishna's mercy coming in their life.
But it's required sometimes to do this outside.
Can you?
It is required sometimes to do this kind of job outside.
Outside meaning?
I mean, non-devotees.
Huh.
Professional life.
Yes.
Sometimes may require this kind of action.
Okay.
I'm talking about managers.
Yeah?
Talking about managers.
Managers, okay. Can you?
No, managers will pinpoint this because of you are like this, it has happened like this.
Nice that you brought it up. So, first and foremost, I was having a discussion here last week, but I'll continue this again with what we had after the class with the devotee. We think there is spiritual life and there is professional life. Spiritual life is separate from professional life. The scriptures do not encourage that. There is just one life. And that life is spiritual life. Whether you are working in office, you are dealing with a spouse, you are dealing with children, you are dealing with devotees, it's just one life. So, here, like example which Nagaraj could quote, somebody is a manager and he has to provide feedback. What we have to ensure is to see, am I giving a feedback with prejudice? Am I giving a feedback trying to think that, how is it that I put this person down? Then, that is not a spiritual way. The spiritual way is, he is doing some work. My ultimate goal is, no matter whatever work a person does, let them do for the satisfaction of Krishna. I may or may not be able to convince the other person that you are doing this work for Krishna. But at least from my side, I am going to do this work for Krishna. I may be typing a letter. I may be a secretary. But I will type it in such a way that the language will be something which Krishna would like. I will type it in such a way that the qualities which the acharya want others to develop will come in them. There will be kindness, there will be empathy, there will be consideration of the person's aspirations and seeing how we can connect it to Krishna. So, all those thoughts should come in when one is typing a letter or likewise when one is giving a feedback. So, one should think that how is it that I can strengthen the individual? Giving a feedback in this way is still devotion. It is not fighting faults. It is the other way. Finding faults for the sake of putting a person down and ensuring that I grow up and that person doesn't grow, that is a mundane person. But the genuine mood of encouragement is still according to Vaco.
In regard to this only, you told that what is one life, there is only spiritual life. You also told offline discussion, you said, if not for the will of Krishna, that company would have not come up.
Yes.
So we are working for Krishna.
Yes.
So then I just extended this thought to everything we have around.
Yes.
And I was thinking, this automated slaughterhouse, that is also a company. Do you think it's a will of Krishna or Krishna sanctioned this? It is not our aggression.
Which one?
Slaughterhouses. Automated slaughterhouses.
You mean like educational institutions or which one?
Automated slaughterhouses.
Mechanized slaughterhouses.
Actual, for the word, for the literal
automated. Literal.
Yes.
Automated slaughterhouses.
Yes.
That is also an industry.
Yes.
Yeah. So is it Krishna sanctioned or is it our aggression in that case? So if that is also in that case, whatever you told, if I just extend that. Do you think if a company would have not come, Krishna doesn't will? That is what you told. So is that slaughterhouse also, that is also a company now.
Correct.
People work for that also.
True.
Yeah. So is that a will of Krishna also, or sanction of Krishna also?
Okay. I think you know the answer to it. You tell me the answer.
No, I don't know. I'm asking you.
No, maybe. Whatever you think was the answer.
No, seriously, I'm confused. That's why I'm asking.
Anybody here who has some thoughts? Yes, ma'am. Can you come? Because we are recording here and others will not be able to hear.
So Lord gives free will to everybody, so he doesn't interfere with the mind and free will. So he gives us what we want to do. But he also wants us the consequences of what we make it.
Yes.
That's the
thing. Okay. That's one. Anybody else? Any Mataji here?
Maybe you are the last class or classmate before that weekend. There is nothing good or bad. There are consequences.
Yes.
So if you want to take, Krishna will allow you, but face the consequence.
True. That is there.
This is what is.
This is one point.
Yeah.
But the point you raised is important here, which is any circumstance that comes in our lives is for our learning. It is for us to connect to Krishna. This is a fundamental thing here. But there is also a choice we need to make. And part of the choice is, or let me say the choice later. There is no activity in this world which is completely pure. Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, every action is fraught with some faults. That is there for sure. Either it is 5% fault, 100% faults. It is fraught with faults. Whether you work for a company which is building a chip, or you work for a slaughterhouse, the degree of faults vary. Our objective is to minimize it. And there are certain occupations which we have to completely desist from. And one of those occupations which we have to desist is the slaughterhouse occupation. If somebody is put in that situation, we have to try our best to come out of it as soon as possible. Why? We had the example of Rupa Goswami we discussed. The king was slaughtering devotees. I mean, you consider slaughtering animals or slaughtering devotees. And he was also slaughtering cows. Rupa Goswami is in that situation where he was serving the king to expand his dominion and control and finances, etc. He decided no more. And therefore he came out of it. So if we find ourselves in such a situation, the right thing to do is like what Rupa Goswami did, get out of that situation. Then you can also see, for example, I am working in a company which is just doing some product. Like say for example, I am doing one capacitor. Okay, capacitor is one electrical component. What is the point here? These capacitors are used for, you know, all nonsensical things. It may be used for some disco lights which are used in some discotheque. But the same capacitor can also be used in a microphone, which can be used for, say, maybe Srila Prabhupada has used it while recording the lectures and while speaking. It can be used this way, that way. There are some things which can be used in a good way and bad way. That's okay to do. But something which is explicitly against the Shastras and against the four regulative principles, get out of it.
My question was in the beginning. Existence of this, or these companies come up, is it a will of sanction?
How many people said this is sanctioned due to the desire of the individual living entity and the result of their karma? One is that the living entity has the desire to do this kind of thing, exhibit this kind of aggression, and they also need to have that karma to exhibit it. Otherwise, they will be the one upon whom somebody will commit an aggression. So both have to match together, and then they come that way. So somebody who has committed that aggression becomes an animal in the slaughterhouse as a consequence of his action. Somebody who has not yet come to that stage will come here. We need to charger should be, it should be, no? Let's see how it goes. Likewise, Krishna said to Uddhava in the Bhagavatam, whoever indulges in praising or criticizing qualities and behavior of others will quickly become deviated from his own best interest by his entanglement in illusory dualities. Yes, Madhurabhu. Yes.
He said that one person who has after God developed this karma, then everybody was doing that, daily work for
Anybody who is?
Doing the daily work, like going to office, being under supervision of
yes.
the manager.
Yes.
Then how is that behavior that is trying to come out of it? To a special life, right?
So we have been given an occupation and everything because of our karma. So the question is?
How do we try to realize that and try to come out of this?
How do we try to realize and come to spiritual life? That's just due to the mercy of the sadhu. That's it. It's Krishna's mercy. Krishna's mercy can come in various ways. It is jnanam, this is called as a sukriti. To come to spiritual life, we need what is called as a sukriti. There is karmarmukha sukriti. We might do some activities. Like say for example, I might help a devotee in some way or the other. Or I might just do some religious activity. That helps to some extent. There is jnanamukha sukriti, in which I somehow get a spiritual literature and I read it, and through that I get some understanding. Then there is bhaktyonmukha sukriti, where by devotional service we get the credits. The credits like helping, assisting a devotee, or hearing favorably to a devotee, serving a devotee, so many ways. Through that, mostly it is through this bhaktyonmukha sukriti that we can get attracted to the path of bhakti. Even through karmonmukha sukriti, jnanamukha sukriti, we can come to the platform of religious life. But it is bhakti which comes through a devotee which actually takes us.
So here bhakti ultimately purify ourselves.
Yes, with bhakti we can ultimately purify ourselves. True. So our entire objective here is how we can access more and more of this bhakti so that we can be purified. Then, what does this Bhagavad Gita say? So now we come to Bhagavad Gita, our principal scripture. Bhagavad Gita says, austerity of speech consists in speaking words that are truthful, pleasing, beneficial, and not agitating to others, and also in regularly reciting Vedic literature. So this, the word that is used in the 15th verse of the 17th chapter is another word for Vegam, Vacho Vegam, Anudvega. That's the way it is said there. One. So, what are the key points here which Krishna is telling to Arjuna? Number one, we should be truthful. Second is, we should be speak in such a way that it is beneficial to others and it does not agitate others. And third, we should regularly recite scripture. So, let me take an example of the first truthful. I keep giving assignments. Some devotees write assignments. Here is what one devotee submitted as an assignment. And the question that I had given, that was, this was the response to the question given by Harikshetra Prabhu on the same Vacho Vegam verse. He had asked about the scripture talks about not committing sinful activities in your own life and following four regulative principles. In your own life, tell me how you are following doing that. That was his question. This devotee writes here, in many situations, due to laziness, not able to follow Krishna conscious activities regularly, that devotee is saying that, like not able to read or hear lectures. Sometimes I like the seniors that we are very busy, that we are not able to do the above activities. And then the devotee gives statement from chapter 9, next 30 of Bhagavad Gita saying, Api chet sudaracharo pachate mananya bhag sadhu eva samanyasya samyak yavastha hi saha. The Prabhupada explains that the material contamination is so strong that even a yogi fully engaged in service of the Lord sometimes becomes ensnared. Since we are in a conditioned state and our material contamination is strong, we commit mistakes. The point I'd like you to see here is, this is a devotee like you sitting in this class. How many of you in this class know me before I started speaking here? 40%. 50% of the students here, or the participants here, didn't know me before. This devotee is one among them. And when you have to write to somebody about your own weaknesses, it is not easy. This is a very tough thing to do. And yet, here is this devotee who is truthful. What Krishna sees is not whether you are successful or not. What he sees is the attitude he sees. This being truthful is an example of humility. And just by this act, that saying, I'm unable to speak the truth here, of saying, I have time, but you know, there's some laziness in me, and expressing it this way. That is a quality which means that this particular devotee is actually having this austerity of speech. She's truthful. So, that's one. Second is, it should be such a way that it is beneficial to others, and at the same time, it does not agitate others. Many times, we think Prabhupada's mood of speaking is, say something and tell it to everybody. Hit somebody on their head. Take Shastra and hit it on their head. Whereas, if we see Prabhupada's statements clearly, Prabhupada was a multifaceted person. He knew how to deal with different kinds of people. Plus, the important thing which was operating in his life is he was in touch with the Paramatma. So, a general principle which, if you observe from Srila Prabhupada's interactions, which you see here is, number one, with disciples, those who have committed their life to him, be straight and clear and correct them when required. Because that's the role of a guru. He was fulfilling his role of a guru. A guru is not meant to please disciples. He is not meant to pander to their innermost wishes. Oh, you are so nice, you are so good. Because Srila Prabhupada did not want something from them for himself. He wanted them to go back to Krishna. That was his objective. So with those who are committed, speak straight and be clear. Like for example, there is this one fast time here. Srila Prabhupada went to Vrindavan sometime and he had two disciples. One was a mother and the other was her daughter. And the daughter was in a terminally ill situation. I don't know. Those days, I don't know. It was probably cancer, but they don't know, I don't know whether it was diagnosed or not. So Srila Prabhupada came there, the mother and daughter came there, and the daughter was about passed away from her body. She had come to leave her body in Vrindavan. And Srila Prabhupada had also come. So they both came to meet Srila Prabhupada. And both of them were crying. And this young daughter, she was hardly like some 80 to 20 years of age. Very young daughter. And the mother was like somewhere in the 40s, 50s. Both of them were crying. And Srila Prabhupada said, in this material world, nobody will live. Everybody has to die. You have to die. I have to die. Everybody has to die. Don't think that anybody is going to live. And he repeated this point again and again. But then the mother and daughter couldn't control their tears. And then Srila Prabhupada said, but Srila Prabhupada, I am afraid. Prabhupada said, why are you afraid? You have to die anyways. A devotee who chants Krishna's name will go back to Godhead. Others will not have to. Others will have to be in this material world. But Srila Prabhupada, I am afraid that if I die, what will happen to me? What will happen to me in my next life? Prabhupada said, see, you are chanting the holy name. You are definitely going to get, at least in the worst case, you are going to get a human body and you will be born in a rich family. And you will continue your life. Don't be afraid. So, Srila Prabhupada spoke in this way. He didn't tell them that everything will be alright, it's okay. So, he was interacting in this way with his disciple. Now, the same thing when you go to somebody else, like a person who is not a devotee, Srila Prabhupada is cautious. He would try to see to what extent, if he speaks, the person can take something back. He wouldn't go to smash all this. So, we have to understand that carefully. And in some cases, when he knew the mood of the individual, he would be very hard on the individual. A classic case is that of Dr. Patel. If you read Prabhupada's conversations with Dr. Patel, there are a series of conversations in Juhu. Dr. Patel was not a devotee, but Srila Prabhupada would often hammer him left, right and center. Because he understood, and like at the end of their interactions, Dr. Patel became a devotee. Why? If you analyze the nature of certain individuals, some individuals need hard tools. So, for such individuals, Srila Prabhupada recognized that nature. And to that said, individuals Prabhupada would hammer them directly. Some people are capable of receiving it. Some people are not capable of receiving it. And therefore, Srila Prabhupada would interact with them accordingly. One classic example, okay. How many of you know here Gaurija Prabhupada? Oh no, okay. His wife's name is Jagat Tarini Mataji. She was a model before coming to devotional life. She was a model in Australia. You know, like, you know, all wearing all kinds of dresses and all kinds of heel shoes and strutting in front of the ramp and everything. Bhurishan Prabhu joined ISKCON movement in the State University of New York at Buffalo sometime in 1966-67. And Mataji also was, that was in Buffalo, New York, in USA. Mataji was from Australia. She was a model in Australia. So somehow their marriage was arranged. They got married. And Srila Prabhupada sent them to, I think, Hong Kong, if I'm right. It is Hong Kong. No, it's Hong Kong. So there was a phase in the movement at that time where Srila Prabhupada took another disciple. His name was Siddha Swarup Maharaj. And how many of you know this pastime as I'm saying this? One thing. Anybody else? Okay. Siddha Swarup Maharaj was formerly a big impersonal guru. And he had seen, like in one sense he expressed it, that he had seen the Brahman effulgence. He had experienced it before meeting Srila Prabhupada. He had like 20 disciples also. But when he heard Srila Prabhupada, he felt this is the ultimate guru. So he surrendered to Srila Prabhupada along with his disciples. Usually ourselves going is tough, especially when I'm in a big position. On top of it, telling all my disciples, he is the ultimate Jagat Guru. That is very tough. Srila Prabhupada recognized some genuineness in him and told him that he gave him initiation and gave him he made him a sannyasi directly. And he's preaching even today. Those of you who do follow news, there is a Democrat representative in the United States Parliament, Tulsi Gabbard. She is his disciple in one sense. So, Siddha Swarup Maharaj started speaking about Bhagavatam and he had a particular perspective. He came from his own way of preaching, and at that time devotees were engaged in distributing books. And the devotees used to do hook or put, distribute books. And this Siddha Swarup Maharaj didn't like it. And here you see that Bhurijan Prabhu was in touch with Siddha Swarup Maharaj. Bhurijan Prabhu came from State University of New York in Buffalo. He is the more of the intellectual kind. He is not the street seller kind. Do whatever. There are the salesman kind who can do whatever it takes. He is more of the intellectual kind. And even today, you see his presentations. Very intellectual. So somehow he aligned himself with Siddha Swarup Maharaj and he stopped distributing books. And slowly he stopped changing the, he changed the Mangalarti program every day. He stopped going out and he just thought that let us get people come in and we'll give them a quality Krishna conscious presentation, etc., etc. Srila Prabhupada got to know about this program, that his distribution of literature is stopping. What did he do? He came to Hong Kong. I think it was, I may be wrong, it's Hong Kong or Tokyo, but he said, pardon me for that mistake there. He took a flight to Hong Kong and he came. Satsuru Maharaj is there in the car. And then it was like, you know, a limousine. There's a driver, there's somebody in the front. And then there's the back cabin, which is completely like soundproofed. Srila Prabhupada was sitting in the back seat. Bhurijan Prabhu was sitting in the front. Right away Srila Prabhupada started having. So you think you know everything? Why are you not following the program you have given, that I have given you? You are not following your spiritual master. Am I your spiritual master or not? And when Prabhupada used to speak like this, sometimes his limbs used to quiver. His limbs used to move up and down, shouting left, right and center. It was very hard on Bhurijan Prabhu. And Bhurijan Prabhu was silent. They reached the apartment place. And then Srila Prabhupada went to the first floor. He continued chastising his disciple. And then Bhurijan Prabhu's wife, Jagat Tharani Mataji, also got to know this. I mean, she came down and she was hearing this chastisement. She was a new devotee. Her faith was now going in all, both directions. I surrendered my modern life. 100 people will look at me on the ramp. 10,000 people will look at my photos. And so many people will just go gaga at me. And here I am wearing one sari, hardly getting anything to eat, distributing books here. And on top of doing all of this, he's shouting at us. Is happening here. And when she went inside, then Srila Prabhupada called for her. Then when he called for her, he saw her. She was trembling. He could sense what was happening in her. Then he called her near him. He took a ring from his finger and said, take this, this is my marriage. He won. That same person, to both the couple, he won both of them differently. One person could take the chastisement, and to this date, he is commenting on Srila Prabhupada's literature. Like he's written Unveiling His Lotus Feet, he's written commentary, like, surrendered to his feet. So, Bhagavatam commentary, Bhagavatam commentary, trying to see, this is what Srila Prabhupada tried to say, this is what he wants to do. Interactions which can change. That is Vachavegam. That is how our Acharya teaches us. So it should be in such a way that it is beneficial and does not agitate us. This is an example of a quote. And another thing is, we have to regularly recite scripture. In the purport, Srila Prabhupada writes, teacher should not speak to those who are not his students if he will agitate their minds. This is a principle which Srila Prabhupada followed with us. And second is, one should quote scripture for statements or understanding. That is control of speech. So this is something which is very unique which Srila Prabhupada has done. If you see all other religious movements, they will speak any nonsense. They, in the name of spirituality, they will put forth their own understanding. But within ISKCON, anybody who speaks something, you see one thing which is common. Whether you go to Delhi Center, whether you come to Bangalore Center, or you go to New York or anywhere, the common training given to everybody is, make a statement, quote scripture. It is not my own qualification that comes. It is the Acharya's qualifications and the literature, the worth of the literature. And second, third thing which Srila Prabhupada said is, speak in such a way that it is pleasurable to the ear. And different disciples of Srila Prabhupada have taken it in a different way. They have their own ways of making this pleasurable to the ear. Some analyze Shastra and make it pleasurable to the ear. Some give pastimes from various literature and make it pleasurable to the ear. So they all have done differently. Something that we have to understand here is like Srila Prabhupada is like a cotton pick. From the cotton, from a ball of cotton, you can take a pick and you can take some strands of cotton and you can make a pick. You can make a small pick, you can make a big pick. And Srila Prabhupada is this multifaceted personality. And different devotees take different aspects of this multifaceted personality and amplify it. And which means, in our own lives, we have to find what is it that about Srila Prabhupada's multifaceted personality that appeals to us. We have to see what is it that I most closely resonate with, and we have to go further in that. We may not be able to go through all the aspects of Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada stressed on book distribution. Srila Prabhupada stressed on character development. He is stressed on preaching. He is stressed on opening more temples. He is stressed on farm communities. There will be individuals within this movement who can do all this. And there will be some of us who can do one of this or maybe half of this. That's okay. How much work we do, let it be an offering for Srila Prabhupada. Now, what happens if we don't speak Krishna Katha? I think we'll have to stop after this. The examples also I couldn't come to today. We'll come to it next week. The result of not speaking Krishna Katha is that this form of their life is wasted. Why? Shravanaka says in the Srimad Bhagavatam, both by the rising and by setting, the sun increases the duration of life of everyone, except one who utilizes the time by discussing the topics of the all-good personality of Godhead. So, this is the importance of the Vachavegam. There's a nice thing which is more technical and detailed, but the essence, it's about... let's not get into it. But the essence here is, one who speaks about Krishna Katha, you will find that automatically he has more time to do everything. His time span increases. The more and more we engage in Krishna consciousness, the more and more we engage in bhakti, we find that we have more things, more time to do the things that we could never do before. But on the other hand, if we make our mind go into multiple directions of topics or activities which are not related to Krishna, we will never find time. That is why it is found that those who have a very good sadhana, those who wake up early in the morning, finish their chanting in a nice way, not just to finish it, chant Hare Krishna Mahamantra in a mood to connect with Krishna, and then spend some time in Shastra, you find that the quality of life improves. So Ayur Harati Vai Pumsam, that's how this verse goes. Ayur Harati Vai Pumsam Udayam Astanta Yam Asav. The ayur is robbed away. Material energy robs one's life if one does not engage in Krishna. Then more and more one engages, she material energy finds, she takes her influence away, and we are able to have great fulfillment. Next, if we don't speak and hear Krishna Katha, what will we do? This is again a very classic verse in Srimad Bhagavatam from the same second canto. Shaunaka Rishi says, what will we do if we don't hear Krishna Katha? He says, we will live our life like a dog, hog, camel or ass. How many of you have heard this? Raise your hands, please. Yeah. So what is a dog? What does a dog do? A dog will faithfully serve a master. And what does it expect from the master? Maybe a few breadcrumbs. And like that, all of us go to some companies. We faithfully think that that person will come and that person is the one who is controlling my life. If he doesn't give money, I cannot do anything. So for whatever he says, I will do. My life, without that company, without this master, it means nothing. We think that way. So to the extent that we think, do I have time to read Krishna Katha? No. If I don't spend more time in office, I will not be able to sustain my life. Krishna Katha doesn't sustain my life. The money that I get from my office, the recognition that I get from my office, that sustains my life. The dog is waiting for that recognition, and our life becomes like that of a dog. Next is hog. The more we hear, we get to understand what is useful in our spiritual life, what is not useful. And accordingly, what we eat, what we digest, changes. What does a hog do? Whatever is given to it, it eats. What do? We know that these are the food in the mode of goodness, passion, ignorance. I should eat only those which are in the mode of goodness. Even in the mode of goodness, only after I offer it to the Supreme Lord, only then I can partake. But a hog doesn't have that mentality. Eat anything. If not for this Krishna conscious movement, where would we be? We might have been born in a family of vegetarians, but we will go to McDonald's and eat some veggie burger. And what do we do by going to McDonald's and eating veggie burger? We are actually financing McDonald's to kill another animal for a chicken burger. So, that same activity has given rise to karma in which we are implicated. I eat a veggie burger, but I am implicated in the killing of chicken burger. And next birth, who knows where I go? Who knows how much I am going to suffer? And then people say, why am I suffering in this world after doing all of this? Next is the camel. The camel is known for eating the cactus. It eats the thorns. And when it eats the cactus, the thorns prick its tongue. And when it pricks its tongue, it starts bleeding. And then it drinks its own blood. When it drinks its own blood, it finds the relish. And Srila Prabhupada, in his Bhagavad, he compares that this camel is the exemplar of a person who tries to enjoy sex life. Because when one enjoys sex life, what happens? There are vital fluids in the body which get dissipated. How do these vital fluids in the body come about? 60 drops of blood or all vital ingredients together make one drop of semen. And then one is wasting that. And he says, the one who is trying to engage and enjoy sexual activities is actually like a camel. So what do we do? If we don't if we don't read Shastra, then we will be like camel. There is no guidance for us. So I hope you are getting the connection. Vacho Vegam means speaking about Krishna Katha. Speaking about Krishna Katha means first read Krishna Katha. Then we can speak about it. If we read Krishna Katha, then our attitude changes. We will not act like a dog. We will not act like a hog. We will not act like a camel. And we will not act like an ass, which works very hard and only gets its enjoyment as reward. Foolishly working when the resources for maintenance exist. And further, what actually also happens in reality is that if we don't get access to Krishna Katha, not only do we act like this, we also proclaim the greatness of others who are doing this. See, that person who is working in the company, 30 years he worked for the company, he never came home at all, and today he is the CEO of the company. Such a great person. Our glorification is of people who are like dog or camels in dust. See, Salman Khan, what a great hero he is. What a great body he has. So, our inspirations will change by connecting to Shastra. Yes.
I have one doubt.
Ah.
So, I was attending one of the classes. See, if I talk about a doctor or an engineer who develops something new.
Right.
And if you don't do those kind of research, invest our time, so we will not be able to make our example, not try to innovate something new. Because the kind of the world we live in, we have to regularly read something new. If we are not reading, we will be behind and we will not be able to cope up with it. Way the industry is moving.
Okay.
So you need to do research in some of the other way, and you need time for that.
Okay, I get your point.
And in 8 hours you spend in the office,
yes,
you need some extra time to study further.
True.
But when we say that is work of a hog or an ass, like it is without that also we can survive. It is really not something in problem.
Yes.
If we follow proper routine philosophy. Or if we just cultivate some grain and have some cows, we can survive.
Yes.
But still cannot bring them.
Yes.
So how to solve this kind of problem?
So the problem is
catch 22.
Yes.
It's never any solution.
True. The world is structured. So such points here. So one conception is, in order to simplify our life, we have to keep inventing new things. And only when we invent these new things, we can sell these products. And through this, the economy will grow. Only then we can get prosperity. Through that, we get money. And some devotees will even say, how can you maintain this temple? Only if I go build this new product, make money and give it donation to you can sit and do here. Otherwise, how can you even make prasadam? Srila Prabhupada actually said that Krishna doesn't require anything from us in this kind of an angle. In fact, from his own life, during World War II, what he found was that when there was bombing in Calcutta, Srila Prabhupada thought probably the Gaudiya Mutt needed some help. So what he did is he went to the Gaudiya Mutt and said, do you need something? Do you need some rice? And there is all these things happening around. You may be having a shortage. Devotee said, what shortage? We have enough. No problem. We have enough to offer to the Lord. We have enough to offer to the devotees also as prasadam. No problem. In this world, honestly speaking, there is no dearth of any resources. So what devotees think is, what will happen to the economy? This economy is going on a catastrophic destination. You can try to add more and more, you can try to generate artificial necessities, but this is going to go off. Now, everybody in this world is not going to come to this a platform of simple living and high thinking. But those who can, those who are convinced, should come to it. They have to minimize their necessities. So that is part of the question to us. The second is, I am in the situation where I have to continuously invent something new. I am put in that job situation. What do I do? For some, what happens, there are two aspects here. There are some who are extremely capable of invention. So they are in the right job profile. Which means, they work for 3 hours, they get to know what to do and they finish it, and 8 hours or 9 hours job work is useful. This is an example of a person whose inner nature and whose job resonate. The problem that happens in this world is, many of us where the resonance doesn't happen. I am not qualified for this job, but yet I do this job. So, in this, two things have to be done. If I am taking more time to do this, it probably means that I have to identify another occupation where I don't need to spend so much effort. Until then, maybe take a little extra time. 8 hours is probably not sufficient. Probably you need 9. Probably you need 10. But one thing, whether you need 9 hours or you need 10 hours, don't sacrifice hearing and chanting. Ensure that the Bhagavatam says that the fruit of one's occupation is that attraction to the message of Godhead increases. Your 8 hours, 9 hours of work, whether you are coming up with a new product or not, if your attraction to hear Krishna Katha increases, you are successful. That is the parameter, that's the barometer, the mark for us. After that, everything else. You may be successful or you may not be successful in coming up with a new product. But what Krishna sees is not that. You have put your effort and accordingly Krishna will arrange the rest of the circumstances. Third thing, which is in continuation with what I said, one has to continuously, at least in this economy, put active efforts to see what is the right occupation for me. In this economy, like we often think it's like our father's time, where one job, 30 years, same thing, go in the morning at 8 o'clock, come at 5, and do the same job continuously. That economy has almost vanished, at least in Bangalore. Here, people's job profiles change, the nature of their work will change, and you have to continuously learn something new. Don't treat it as a burden. Treat it that I can serve Krishna nicely. Let me see that way in which I can serve Krishna. Plus, from the way you appear, you look quite young. As a person becomes older, what kind of work that they can do will also change. When a person comes to 35 or 40, he can no longer do what he used to do previously. When he becomes to 50, he cannot do. One of the problems we face is, we continuously hear, just like this, if we don't hear Krishna Katha, we continuously hear, only an engineer is great. Only a person who invents is great. Therefore be an engineer. Therefore be a doctor. And so even when we have to migrate to a new job profile, we feel, am I becoming something lower? Am I losing something? No. The point is, the society artificially imposes certain values on us. And we, by our own conditioning, put some more buffalo dung on us. It's better that we clean the cow dung of Krishna. So, we need to get an inspiration to make choices and to go forward with our choices. Examples from scripture actually give us that courage to go forward. If you say, for example, let us say we have our brahmacharis here, they had a wonderful degree. Why did they choose here? They had the courage. Only when we connect to scripture, we will get that courage. Otherwise, the courage is shallow, it is not deep. That's the point.
Today morning, I was hearing Prabhupada. The first point which you said, that is enough resources. He was telling, repeatedly, there is so much land everywhere. Go to America, go to Australia, so much land that is enough to feed 10 times the population. 10 times the population. 10 times the population can live happily. This is one part. The second part, I asked a similar question like as a college student long back to a devotee. He was telling repeatedly, you should do this. He said, everybody keeps doing this.
Yes.
Suppose, take a situation, a hypothetical situation where everybody is just doing kirtan, katha and bhajan and all. Who will feed them? If they stop working and they just do worship, who will feed them? So Krishna will personally come and feed everybody. Don't worry about them.
Yes.
That's what the senior devotee gave answer to. That Krishna will personally, if you are doing that, you are literally doing that, he will come and feed each one of you, don't worry about it. That's the answer I got when I was a student.
So adding to Nagarajan's point, occupational duties should not be seen just as a means for our food, clothing, shelter. It should be seen as a means to engage our energy in Krishna service. That should be the primary motive. So it can be occupation in the hospital, in the office, or somebody can be a housewife, somebody can be a teacher, but all of them are using their abilities to connect to Krishna. When seen in that way, we'll be happy with ourselves. When we are happy, we'll make more devotees also. So, yeah. One more session of Vachavegam next week. Okay? So, thank you very much. Any other comment, question? Anybody here?
Krishna wants to control everything. He is the supreme controller.
Okay, he is the supreme controller.
Yeah, he enjoys. He is the supreme enjoyer.
Yes.
Why he has given us this free will? We are not that much capable of controlling our free will. We do wrong things. Why this quality has been given to us?
Classic question. I want one Mataji to answer here. So Mataji.
The last idea devotee to Prabhupada. So Prabhupada says here, this is our goal.
Yes.
He doesn't want, Krishna doesn't want us to become a goal. He wants, we are just abhishas. We are like Krishna. We are not goals.
Yes. So the point, as Mataji said, is Krishna is complete, but he is incomplete. Opposites are there again. He is complete in that he has everything. He is incomplete that he wants love from his part and parcels, his yearning for the love. Love can come only when there is free will. Without free will, there is no love. So, exercising that free will means exercising one's love for somebody. And when we do that way to Krishna, that I choose Krishna over anything else. I choose his pleasure over anything else. I choose the pleasure of his servant over anything else. That is an indication of loving relationship. And Krishna is so enamored by our love that he completely gives everything to us. Says, now you take charge. And the devotee says, no, actually I want to be with you. So it's a competition. It's a transcendental competition.
So he causes such a wrong thing where people have been slaughtered over the world saying that's a thing that is properly that is from everybody.
Sorry,
yeah. And leading to so many other karmas and endless work cycles.
True.
Leading to so many.
Yes. But if I don't give free will, what happens?
That love will be.
Yes. So from Krishna's perspective, he doesn't want us to come here. But nonetheless, he is such a servant that he will even create a material world with so many, like there are so many Brahmandas, in that there are so many lokas, in that there are planets, for that there are so many Brahmas, each of different heads. He does all of this for us, saying, I know this is bad, but you want this, so I'll give it to you. This is how even parents do. If you see parents, children often say, Daddy, Mummy, I need this. They know it is bad for the child. They keep telling the child, please, this is not good for you. But finally, the child has to come out of it. Sometimes, they will tell him, in a controlled way, do so much. You learn over a period of time how it is bad. So, it's up to us. We may see that many times, this question has a different flavor also. People don't explain this flavor. The flavor is, why has Krishna put me in this situation where I have to exercise my free will? Why do I have to suffer so much? And why do I have to exercise my free will to go back to him? You make me do it, right? It is an example, this is an indication of the laziness of the person. A person who is lazy in activity will have this kind of a thought. So we have to come out of our laziness. So, many times we'll have to think that if I want everything to be perfect around me and then I'm just going to come and enter the situation, like a Vyasa Puja is happening, I come and give my blessings to everybody. That's not the way it's going to happen. And that's why if you see the Shastras, spiritual life is very dynamic. Even the gopis of Vrindavan, the liberated souls, they were constantly in anxiety. All that Krishna is guaranteeing us through the pages of Bhagavatam is, you will have anxiety. Whether you have anxiety to serve me or you have anxiety in serving Maya, that is your choice. Laziness is not allowed in this realm. In this realm of the spiritual realm. Okay? I'll stop here. Jagat Sakshi Prabhu's class will start soon. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki
jai.
Srila Rupa Goswami Prabhupada ki
jai.
Tagore Premanante
Hari Bol.
And I'm here to hear the verses that you have memorized and I will note it down. And Varada Krishna Prabhu has also asked me to take an attendance. I had an Excel sheet but I didn't bring my laptop unfortunately. So I might just note down your name quickly and please give your name, recite the verse and then go. Okay? Thank you.